Are you able to see the screen now?
Yes, sir. Now we are able to see.
Yeah. Thank you. First thing is, when you say all are vaccinated, okay, the all already tells me that I have to use this quantifier. This is called a quantifiers. There are two quantifiers. One is there exists, other is for all. Okay. Now, this statement already involved this quantifier. But whenever there is a quantifier, there is also a set involved with that. Because this quantifier says all in some set have some property. So, what is this all? We are in a country. So, what you are talking about is the people of the country. Therefore, the set is here, the set of people in the country. Let us call the country as C. You understand this? Okay. So, let us call this P, the set of people in the country C. Therefore, what this says is, for every X in P, what does this mean? For every X in P, P is a set of people in the country C. So, for every X meaning for every person in the country, what we want to say is X is vaccinated. How many of you understand this? How I got it? How I wrote it? Please say yes if you understand. Quick. Do you have any idea of how many participants are there, Sukumar? Okay. Have you understood this?
Yeah, 95 and 65 of them said yes.
Very good. That's pretty good. Okay. Okay. Now let me give one more example. Let us see whether you can do that. Okay. Let's say all fans in the room are working. So, the first question is, do you understand what are all the quantifiers involved? I'm sure all of you know that, right? Quick. I want fast reactions. We don't know how much time. What quantifiers involved in this? Quick. You don't have to tell me. If you know the answer, say yes. That's it. Please understand the question. Do you see a different number, Sukumar? Very low.
61, I said.
Yeah, see, for me, it's the old thing, so it just shows 8, 7, 9, etc. Okay, that's very good. Please, I mean, confirm that quickly so that I can move.
Okay, sure, yeah.
So, all fans in this room are working. As I said, the quantifier is for all. Now, as I said, whenever there is a quantifier, there is a set involved. What is the set? How many of you know what is the set? Quick. It is, the set is set of fans in the room. Set of fans where? In the room which you are talking about. So, what does it say? It says something, some property. What is the property? For every F in capital F, that is for every fan in the set of fans of the room, F is working. Do all of you understand how it is done? See, this ordinary sentence, we made it a purely mathematical sentence. Okay, this says every F, okay, every fan in the set of fans has some common property. What is the common property? It is working. And here the first statement said, all are vaccinated in a country. Therefore, if I take P to be the set of people in the country, it says every X, an element, every X in that set P shares a common property. What is the common property? Being vaccinated. Okay, do you follow this? So, you should learn how to work this kind of thing. So, now let me say one more thing. All leaves in the tree are green. Think about all the question now you should think about. What is the quantifier involved? What is the set involved? Can you write it the way I wrote? Quick. All these three questions, go through and then say yes or no.
I
57.
Very good. So others should also go through it.
No, 68. No.
Okay. Now now that you have learned how to use this for all, we also use it for each or for all. Okay, we have learned it. Now, what is meant by negation? I want to negate. Negate is same as saying the statement I made is false. It's wrong. It's not true. So when I say all are vaccinated in the country, say if it is false, what does it mean? As I said, English grammar will say all are not vaccinated in the country. But think about mathematically, we will be precise. When I say all are vaccinated in a country is false, that means I can find at least one person in the country who is not vaccinated. Do you understand that? So the moment I say I can find, it is same as saying there exists. Okay. Therefore, there exists a person in the country who does not have the property. Namely, the property is he is vaccinated. So he does not have the property means he is not vaccinated. Therefore, the negation. Okay, this is a statement we are saying for all x in P, x is vaccinated. So it's a negation. Reads like, what does it say? I can find at least one person. That means I can find a person which is same as saying there exists an x in P. Okay. What is P? The set of people in the country. And he does not have this property. What does it mean? X is not vaccinated. How many of you agree with this? This is more precise. So if I have to say that statement is false, what all I have to do is, if I want to prove he is false, then the only way I can do is I have to find a person and exhibit. Okay, look at this guy. This guy is not vaccinated. How many of you understand? Quick.
It 75.
Very good. So how many of you can negate? Go through the negation and you should write the same way as I wrote here. Okay, this is a more precise way of writing negation. So you should be able to write in this fashion, the negation of this statement. How many of you can do? Quickly say how many of you can do that? This statement should be negated and the negation should be written in this form. How many of you can do that? Quick. Okay, can say you call somebody from a group phone, what should I write within the bracket? There exists X in F.
Vidish?
Yes, sir. So for all X belongs to F, F is not working.
So you are not understood, Mr. Nidish? Can. What?
You are. Yes, sir. I understand.
That you are not understood is what you understand?
F is not.
Would you like to correct your answer? Your answer is wrong. Can you correct it? This is a statement. For all x in F, F is working is a statement. What is the negation? See, if you have 10 shirts, if I say all shirts are white, if it is false, what does it mean? All shirts are not white? Or how will you make it more precise statement? Call somebody else, please. Quick. Group 2.
Yes, sir.
No, don't say yes, sir, no, sir, etc. Please answer. What is the negation?
There exists some set X belongs to the set of set.
There exists some set.
There exists some set X.
It's not set. It's an element. F is the set. X is. What is the meaning of this symbol? You know that?
No. Kumarasen is saying shirt. Shirt. You said 10 shirts. No, she is giving answer for that.
Okay.
Huh. Sir, there exists some X belongs to F.
Huh.
In bracket, the shirt is not white. X is not Y chart.
X is not
Y chart.
Okay, very good. So, what is the third statement? So I said all leaves in the tree are green. Okay, let us look at L be the set of leaves on the tree. Okay, then what did I say? For every L in capital L, L is green. Okay, this is a statement. What is its negation? The next group, please ask somebody. Quick.
Amlan.
There exists L in capital L, so that L is not green.
Very good. So, I'll give you 20 seconds. All of you go through the statements. Okay. And review this. 20 seconds. Then we will proceed. Once you are reasonably understood, confident, please say yes, quick.
Yeah, 60 plus, sir, 65.
Okay, that's not very encouraging. I will wait for some more time. I want at least 64.
Now it is crossed.
Now 68.
Very good. Yeah, that's what I was expecting. It should be somewhere around that line. So what you have learned, let us, okay, mathematics is something very interesting. You observe a lot of phenomenon and make it an abstraction, and that abstract statement can be applied elsewhere. This already is abstract, right, for you? So what does it really mean? See, when I took two sheep plus three sheep in a primitive man, he counted as five sheep. Then he had two bananas plus three bananas, he counted as five bananas. Then he found two sisters plus three sisters, he counted as five sisters. Later he made it an abstract statement. He did not define what is two, he did not define what is three, but he said two plus three is five. Now if you tell me you have two brothers and three brothers, then I can tell you two plus three is five, therefore you have five brothers. You understand? That is what mathematics is. Okay, you observed a lot of things, you abstract it and apply that abstract thing to some other situation also. So it's a universal statement now. Okay, if you give me two goes and three goes, then I don't know to say goes exist or not. It's not my question. Two plus three goes will be five goes. You understand? So the statement we had so far is of this following kind. I have a set X and I said every element X in the set has a common property. Okay, I will write as P. This P is some property. Let's not worry about what it is. For example, in the first case, the property was, what was that? I don't know, vaccinated. Second case, it was working. The third case, it was green. You understand? This is a statement. So, if the moment any mathematical statement has this form, if you want to negate it, if you want to say it's false, what should I write? Okay. Next group, please. So I wanted the coordinator to ask next group, please. No, I'm not audible again.
Chinta Rai.
No, you are audible. Sorry.
Bharat Kumar.
What is the negation of the statement? Abstract statement.
There exists some element X belongs to X such that X has not P.
Does not have P. Okay. Do you see that? This is a pattern. So now you can tell me anything, then I know how to negate it mathematically. Okay, keep this in mind. Now we'll go to the next one. Okay, today, nowadays is the mango season. So I bought a basket, okay, of mangoes. Okay, mangoes are green. Okay, I should have some kind of yellow orange, but I don't have that. Okay, these are the mangoes, right? Then I told that guy, okay, I can find one mango which is bad. Okay, in this basket, okay, there is a mango which is bad. What quantifier is used here? When I say I can find a mango which is bad in this basket, what quantifier is used? Quick, next.
There exists.
Very good. There exists, right? So let us give a name. So let M be set of mangoes in the basket. Then what I am claiming? There exists an X in M, a mango in the basket, so that X is rotten, let us say, or overripe. So let's not worry about meaning of all these things. Is that clear? Now the shopkeeper was angry with me. He wanted to say that I am wrong. How will he show that? How will we prove that I am wrong? Put yourself as a shopkeeper's place, then you will know. What will you do? You will take each and every mango in the basket and show it to me. Is it rotten? Is it rotten? Is it rotten? So he will simply say, give me any mango in the basket, I will show it is not rotten. You understand that? So how we will do is, he will give this here, I am going to read it as not for all, I will see me given any. Given any X in M, okay, I will say that X is not rotten. That is how shopkeeper will try to prove. How many of you just spend about 10 seconds, make sure. I am not reading for all X in M, X is not rotten. You understand? If you say for all X, that means for not all mangoes are rotten. That means some may be rotten. You understand that? So you should not read this statement as for all. It's better to read it as given any. Okay? Yeah. Otherwise, you will read for each mango is not rotten, or not all mangoes in the basket are not rotten. That gives rise to a suspicion some mango may be rotten. Okay, then I am not false. Okay, what I said may be true. Please spend 10 seconds, I'll keep quiet. So can I go ahead? Yeah. So if I have to negate this statement, then I have to use this. Okay, let us look at one more example. Okay, I said, okay, let us have a tree, the set of leaves. Then I want to say there exists a leaf, okay, such that L is brown. Right, this statement I am claiming. I found a tree. I said, look at the set of leaves in that. I said there is a leaf which is brown. So if you want to prove me wrong, what should you do? You check each and every leaf and show that it is not brown. Maybe it is red. You understand? Maybe it's black. Maybe it is green. But it's not brown. You understand that? So that means give me any L in L. What I have to show? Can somebody complete this?
L is not brown.
Yeah. Why somebody is, I mean, we are not asking. Somebody is answering on her own.
Ananta
Krishna. Kumar, you should avoid this.
Yeah. Ananta Krishna.
Please.
L is not brown.
Yeah. My request to students is do not give the answer orally. I already told you many times. Yesterday also it was given instruction. Please remember that. Okay, one of us will ask specific name, that person should answer, because we want everybody to think. This is clear to all? Yes. So can somebody make an abstract statement out of this now? So we had already given two examples. The statement started with there exists X in M something. Then I also gave its negation, right? So can somebody give me an abstraction like this? That what is abstraction? The abstraction as I did here. Can you make a mathematical abstraction of this? Whatever we did in this case. Notice that both the statements started with there exists. Then I negated. Yeah, can you ask somebody, Sukumar?
Yes, sir. There exists a person, P belongs to the set P, all people set of all people, who is not.
We are not worried about. Please listen to me. We are not worried about any particular example. Okay. I'm not talking about, okay, two fingers plus three fingers. I am asking an abstraction of that. I am looking for a 2 + 3 = 5.
Okay. Kind of statement. X belongs to X.
Yes.
X is L.
X is not L. It has some property. Please remember. That is why I keep insisting. I am using a word so that it will be mnemonic. It will trigger your memory. P stands for some property. Okay.
Yes.
You want to say there is an X. So that X has some special property possibly. That it is brown or that it is rotten. These are the properties. You understand? So what is its negation? Next student, please.
Saina.
Negation is... For all X.
No. I'll give you zero if you say for all.
Given any.
Very good. Given any X in capital X. Okay, take any. Okay, you take any X, then that X does not have property P. You understand that? For example, take any leaf of the tree, then L is not, that tree, that leaf is not brown. Okay, take any mango in that basket, that mango is not rotten. Do you follow that? How many of you understood? Please say yes if you are understood.
Yeah, 65.
65? Very good. That's good. So, now let's look at, we had already made two abstractions now. Okay, this is how you do mathematics. Okay. Okay. So, the first abstraction started with for all. Okay. This quantifier. Then how did it start? For all X in X, X has property P. So every X has the same property, then I will think of it as a common property. Okay. This all is some kind of intuition. You don't have to worry about common or anything. Now its negation says there exists an X in X such that X does not have that property. Because all of them are supposed to have the property. If it is false, at least somebody does not have that property. Do you see that? It's all common sense. Logic is common sense. Okay. Think about it. Don't get worried about your 12th standard, okay? Syntax logic. Now let's look at the next thing. This statement all started with there exists quantifier. So there exists an X, that is, there I can find an element with some special property P. I'm thinking of a special because I want to say only one, not everybody has possibly. That's why. Okay. Maybe everybody has, that doesn't matter. So its negation means what? Take anybody in that set. That element does not have property P. Have you understood? Have you internalized? Let us use it to do a mathematical statement, right? Suppose A is a non-empty subset of R. R is a set of real numbers. And suppose alpha is a real number. I say alpha is an upper bound. If all elements of A share a common property. What is the common property? You give me any element x in A, I know x, I want x must be less than or equal to alpha. Do you understand this definition? Quick. So when I say alpha is an upper bound of A, I am saying all elements I have, all elements of A have a common property, share a common property. What is the property? Each and every one of them is less than or equal to alpha. Try to always internalize, okay? Just don't cram it. Say it in your own words, in your own language. It may be right or wrong. Don't worry. Slowly you will see that you improve. You will get it correct all the time. At least lot of time. Right? Now, therefore, if I say alpha is not an upper bound, what does it mean? This statement is false. You understand that? I am making a statement. You give me a real number alpha, you have given me a set A, then there is a relation between alpha and A. What is that? Alpha is an upper bound of A. If something happens, what happens? Every element of A shares a common property. What is the property? X is less than equal to alpha. Now, if I say alpha is not an upper bound, this statement is wrong. So, what does it mean? If the statement is right, every element should have the same property, some common property. That is false. Therefore, what should I do? What should I say? You? Can somebody tell me? Ask next group, please.
Joel Sliba.
There exists an x in A such that x is greater than alpha.
X is not less than or equal to alpha. X does not have property. Now, it is same as saying x is greater than alpha because there we are using law of trichotomy of real numbers. If I don't know law of trichotomy, what all I can say is x is less than or equal to alpha is false. Do you understand this subtlety? But what you said, Joel said, is correct. Absolutely correct. How many of you understand? Quick. Very good. Now let's look at another equally different statement. Okay. Suppose I say every X in R has a multiplicative inverse. The multiplicative inverse, if you don't know that word, it's a reciprocal. Reciprocal means x times 1 upon x equal to 1. That, okay, you call 1 upon x as a reciprocal. Or modern language calls it multiplicative inverse. Right? If this statement is false, what should I say? Quick. Somebody, next.
There exists x belongs to R. X does not have a multiplicative inverse.
Very good. Do all of you agree with this? Yes? Okay. Now let look at one more, then we will go further. Now I say a non-empty subset A of R is bounded above. You know, if I can find a real number alpha such that alpha is an upper bound. Please try to understand mathematics. You know, it's not just for cramming, mugging it up and reciting like mantra. Okay, when I say A is bounded above, what all I have to do is I have to find a real number alpha. That real number alpha should have some property, special property. What is the property? It must be an upper bound for A. See, this is how you should break the sentence and assimilate, try to learn mathematics. Otherwise, you will keep on reciting like mantra. Okay, A is bounded above in R. If I can find an alpha in R, so that alpha is an upper bound of A, you can keep on, okay, mugging it up. Have you understood? So, what quantifier is involved in this statement? Quick. Next. Sukumar, always find the next group. Keep it ready.
Hey, yes, sir. Ramya.
Yes.
What quantifier is involved?
There exists alpha.
Right. There exists. No, no. Please. try to be precise. My question is, what quantifier is involved? The answer should be, there exists. That's it. You understand?
Yes.
That shows you are trying to be precise also. Okay. Otherwise, you are want to just say something. Come to your mind. Whatever comes to your mind. Don't. Okay. Therefore, what does it mean? Alpha is an upper bound of A. If there exists alpha in R. Okay. Not, sorry, alpha is an upper bound. A is bounded above in R. If there is alpha in R, alpha, such that alpha is an upper bound of A. Now, suppose I want to say this statement is wrong, false. Then I have to negate it. Okay? So, what is the definition of A is not bounded above? Ask next person, please.
Are you she?
Given any alpha belongs to R, alpha is not upper bound of A.
Very good. Excellent. Very good. She, do you, all of you notice that?
Thank you, sir.
She said, given any. She didn't say, we know that for all quantifier should be used, but she read it correctly. Given any alpha in R, alpha is not an upper bound of A. So, please go through what you have learned. We have learned two abstract statements. This, given a statement which starts with there exists, how to negate it. And given a statement which starts with for all, how to negate it. Okay, we looked at commonplace real life examples. Then we applied it in two mathematical examples. Okay, I'll give 20 seconds. Please reflect upon. Don't worry about trying to recall everything. That's a mistake all of you do. There is no exam. The important thing is your understanding. Whatever appeals you, try to spend some time, try to see. For example, try to look at this abstraction. These two abstractions, can you get it in your mind? Okay, 20 seconds. So how many answers, please? Hello?
Yes, sir. Only 40 around.
That's not good.
It's increasing.
Once it comes to 60, just let me know.
Yeah, it's crossed 60.
Very good. No, please prompt, okay? Don't be lazy. Because if you are lazy, you are going to suffer because I think you are not understood, so I will repeat. And so it will be boring for you. And second, you could have learned something more, newer things, which you would not learn. So it's in your own interest, you should be prompt in answering. Okay. Now life is not this simple. If you notice so far, all the statements which I made, okay, had only one quantifier. Either for all or there exists. And their negations also involved only for all or there exist. That's it. Okay, life. But unfortunately, mathematics is not that simple. Okay, so we are going to look at a real life example. Okay, I went to a kind of orchard. Or if you want to think of it, orchard is, I mean, full of fruit trees. Think of it as a park. Okay, there are a lot of trees. Right? Then I want to say there exists a tree. Okay, I can find a tree. Okay, full of green leaves. Can you imagine? Just imagine. Put yourself in an orchard, lot of trees. Okay, there is one tree which is full of green leaves. Because there may be other trees which have brown leaves, black leaves, or no leaves. Okay, can you imagine? Now, I challenge you to find how many quantifiers are there. Quick. Can you ask next group? How many quantifiers are there? Don't worry. We are all learning. Okay, you can make mistakes. That's your birthright.
Lakshmi.
There are two quantifiers.
Very good. You had attended YFCM, Lakshmi?
No, sir.
Very good. Excellent then. Okay, so what are the quantifiers? What is the first quantifier?
The first quantifier is there exists.
Very good.
And the second quantifier is for all green leaves.
Very good. For all. Very good. Excellent, Lakshmi. Good. Now, how many of you understand? There are two quantifiers. The moment I say I can find, the same as saying there exists. Okay. If I say, for example, some tree in the orchard is full of green leaves, some tree, when I say, that also means there exists. Do you follow that? So you should look for the quantifier. Okay. It may be hidden in common language, like I can find, for some such thing. They will always be hidden, but you should dig out the correct quantifier. Very good. So there exists a tree. Now, as I said, whenever there is a quantifier, there is a set involved. So Lakshmi said there exists is the first quantifier. What is the set for this? Can you ask the next person, next group?
Payal. Payal.
Next.
Okay. Preeta. Jaya Preeta.
Trees.
No, I can find a tree. I can find a fan. I can find a person who is not vaccinated. I can find a rotten apple. So what is the set involved? Tree is an element. Next, quick. Please think.
Nepur.
Set of all trees.
Set of all trees where? In the orchard.
In the orchard.
Right? So set of trees in the orchard.
And a set of leaves.
Right. No, please. I asked you only one question. Okay. Then what do I want to say? There exists a tree in the set of trees with some property. What is the property? Now I have fixed a tree. Okay. There are so many trees. Okay. Then I fixed a tree. This is the tree I have fixed. There may be more, but at least I fixed one tree. This is the tree. Then what do I want to look at? I want to say there is a second quantifier. What is the second quantifier? Lakshmi said for all. Very good. But there is a, whenever there is a quantifier, there is a set. What is the set? Yeah, can you ask next person?
Hey, Ali.
Leaves are green.
No, I am asking, please. I am asking for the set. You are saying some property. Next.
Sri Lakshmi.
You see that in the classroom, you have to think. It's not like your standard classroom. Okay? You have to think. There will be a lot of pressure. Within a day or two, you will get used to this. Okay? Please do that. Cooperate. Yeah, next.
Sri Lakshmi.
The set of all leaves on the tree in the park.
Right. So, I have a tree. Okay? For this tree, let capital L be the set of trees corresponding to the tree T. Right? Then what do I want? Give me any leaf in this tree. Okay, this is a leaf. Give me any L in L of T. Do you understand why I put this tree? This is not all set of all leaves in the garden. It is only the set of leaves on this particular tree. Then give me any leaf. Then it has some common property. What is the common property? Next person.
Damanpreet. Damanpreet.
Next. If they don't respond, you get to the next one. There will be a network problem possible.
Rupesh Raj.
L is green.
Okay, spend some time. I'll give 20 seconds. This is involved. Many of you are struggling. So go through this. So I said I can find a tree. This is same as saying there is a tree. When I say there is a tree, there is a set. What is that? Set of trees. Where? In that orchard. Very good. So, I fix a capital T for the set of trees in the orchard. Very good. Then what do I want to say? There exists a tree. Okay? Call it. There is a T in capital T with some property. What is the property? Now, I look at the set of leaves on this particular tree. Call it L suffix T. Capital L stands for leaves. of which tree? This particular tree, T. Okay, then what do I want to say? Each one of them share a common property, shares a common property. What is the common property? L is green. Okay, please take a time, go through this. 20 seconds. Once you are understood, say please yes. You don't have to wait for me to ask.
Crossed 60.
Very good. Excellent. Okay. All these things need revision. Okay. That's where the discussion hour is for. Don't kind of get discouraged or anything. You will do that. Okay. Repeated examples will help you. Right. Now I have a classroom. Okay. There are a lot of benches. Right. Now in each bench, there are a lot of students who are sitting. Right. You see that I am doing all these things because when I do mathematics, I always visualize. Okay. When you say a statement, there is a classroom, there are a lot of benches, students are sitting. They don't just like that go for me. I try to visualize this picture in my mind. So this is one thing you have to learn. Even in abstract algebra, you will see you can visualize things. Okay. So always try to visualize. You understand that? Now what I want to say is, okay, there is a bench in which all students are from, let us say, from Telangana. You understand that? Is the statement clear? There is a classroom. There are a lot of benches. Students are sitting on the benches. And I am saying there is a bench in which all students who are sitting on that bench are from Telangana. Quick. All of you tell me what are the quantifiers involved in which order. Quick. You don't have to tell me. Just think. If you have an answer, please say yes. Quick. How many had answered?
40.
Still less. Don't worry about, you know, writing mathematically now. First try to understand.
Fifty-five
less. I want some more. I have drawn a picture also. Is it difficult for you to imagine? There is a class full room in which benches are there. In each bench, students are sitting. I am only claiming there is one bench and everybody is from Telangana. Right?
61.
Very good. So, how do I write this as a statement? What are the quantifiers involved? You already know. I said there is a bench and then for all students. There is a bench. Sorry. I don't want this. Yeah. This is the order in which the quantifiers occur. Okay. Now, for this, there exists, I have to figure out what is the set. I am talking about there is a bench. Therefore, I am looking at set of benches, B. Then what I am saying, there exists a bench in B. Then what do I have? I found this bench. Okay, this is the bench I zeroed upon. Then what do I want to talk about this bench? I am looking at the students on the bench and I say all of them are from Telangana. So what is the set for this for all? Yes?
Swati?
Set of all students in that particular bench.
Right. So, since I fixed the bench, okay, I am talking about students. Let me say, yes, suffix B. This B for the bench. Yes, set of students for this. Then I am looking at every student. Give me any student. Okay, these are the students who constitute S of B. Okay. Then what do I want to say? I want to say, yes is from Telangana. How many of you understand this? Have you written it mathematically now? Quick. You You can think of another symbol also. You can write for every x in x, there is a y in y, etc. But y must be depending upon this x. 61. Don't worry about the b, sb, etc. But you should understand the gist, the meaning. Quick, how many are understood? Huh?
61.
Very good. Okay. Now let's look at both the statements. Both the statements started with there exists, followed by for all. Now I want to negate them. I want to say the statement is false. Let us look at the first statement. The first statement said I can find a tree full of green leaves. Okay, think in terms of common daily language. I can find a tree full of green leaves in this garden. It's false. What does it mean? Give me any tree. Okay, that tree is not full of green leaves. You understand that? Can you visualize that? How many of you can visualize? Quick. Mathematics is fun. It's just common sense. Okay. If maths has been taught like this, you will know how to think mathematics, how to reason in mathematics. Now let's look at this. I said, I have a lot of benches. I said, there is a bench with some special property. I can find a bench with some property. What is that? Everybody on that bench is from Telangana. If it's false, what does it mean? Give me any bench. Okay. You understand that? Give me this bench. Then I can find somebody who is not from Telangana in this. Give me this bench. Then I can find somebody who is not from Telangana. And give me this bench. There is somebody who is not from Telangana. Give me this bench. There is somebody who is not from Telangana. Do you understand that? How many of you can visualize this? Quick. What is the count, Sir Kumar?
62.
Oh, then? Oh, no, please tell me as soon as it crosses 60, I'll go ahead.
Hey, I'm waiting for sir. As soon as it crosses, I'm telling.
Oh, I see. Okay. Right. Do you understand this? Now let's try to negate this 10. Do not worry. It will not be overwhelming. Okay. You can discuss. You will see. Once you get... Because you are never been made to think in a very precise way. That's why you may be struggling. But bear with me. By the end of this hour, you will already be about 50% confident. 80% confident after you discuss with your friends in the discussion room. So the first statement said, there is a tree with some property. That is false. So how do I negate it? There is a tree in this orchard which has some property that is false. That means give me any tree in that orchard, that tree does not have the property. Therefore, the negation of that, how will it start? So this is the original statement. Sorry. There is a T in T, so that for every L in L of T, L is green. Okay. So its negation, how will it start? Look at only the first quantifier. That's why the quantifier also is important, and the order in which we are writing is important. There exists a tree with some property that is false. Therefore, how will I start? Give me any T in T. This statement is false. This is a property. This is a statement for every L. So you fix a T. Then I found the set of leaves on the tree. Then I am claiming something. That statement is false. That means what? Given. So you gave me a T. So I took this LT, the set of leaves on that particular tree. Then what do I want to say? I wanted to say every leaf on this particular tree is green. That is false. So what should I write here? There exists an L so that L is not green. Okay, take about 10 seconds. Go through. As I said, try to visualize. You understand this? So what I have is the picture will be like this. So I have a lot of trees. Okay. What did I say? Give me any tree. Then I can find a leaf which is not green. I can find a leaf here which is not green. I can find at least one leaf which is not green. I can find only at least which is not green. That's what it says. Okay. How many of you can visualize and see this? And this captures the point. I said I can find a tree full of green leaves. That's false. That means whatever tree I take, okay, there is at least one leaf which is not green. Okay. Please try to internalize like this. Quick. How many of you understand? Quick.
Cross 64.
Very good. So now, how many of you can negate this statement? Let me write. I said there exists a bench so that every student in that bench, okay, yes, is from Telangana. Okay. So what does it mean? How many of you can negate this? Quick. Go through it in your mind. If you can negate it, you tell me. Mm-hmm. I already drew a picture also for this. If this is false, give me any bench, I can find somebody who is not from Telangana. Therefore, given any B in B, there exists S in SB, so that S is not from Telangana. 10 seconds. Once you understand, please say yes.
Cross 60.
Ah, good.
54.
Excellent. Very good. Now let's play with the same statement. Let's look at this statement. Another, okay. Now suppose I say for every B in B, there exists S in SB, so that S is from Telangana. How many of you can visualize and see what these two statements actually say? Okay, visualize as I drew a picture, mentally you draw a picture and try to say what it means. It says, there are a lot of benches. I can find one bench in which everybody is from Telangana. What does this say? This says something else. It says, take any bench, okay? There will at least be somebody in that bench who is from Telangana. Are these two statements the same? Okay, I give you 10 seconds. Please try to understand. Okay, if you want, I will draw a picture so that, okay. This is the first, okay. Then I have a bench in which everybody is from Telangana. And this statement says something else. This statement says, there are many benches. In each bench, I can find at least one from Telangana. You see that visualization makes you understand easier. Okay, now can you tell me? Are these two statements the same? Quick, yes or no? If they are the same, say yes. If they are not, say no. Be careful. If they are the same, say yes. If they are not the same, say no.
Yeah, 62.
Very good.
One yes, it says.
Who is that? Yes, call out that person. Maybe you know by habit you might have clicked. Call out that person, please.
Ankita Yadav. Ankita.
Are they same or not, Ankita?
Two people said yes now.
No.
Yeah. Huh?
No, sir. They are not same.
Very good. The other person?
Sweta Gandhi. She said yes.
No, that's why the question was not understood. Okay, that's why I said, be careful. I said that, but they missed it. See, you have to be alert in my class. Okay, they are not the same. The picture only shows, right? Here it says, there is at least one bench. Everybody is from Telangana. Whereas it says, give me any bench. At least one student in that bench must be from Telangana. They do not convey the same thing. Okay? Right. Now let's negate it. Okay, let us negate the second statement. This statement, and now I want to look at its negation. So what does the second statement said? You start, give me any bench and I can find at least one student from Telangana. So given any bench, something is true. That's false. That means what? There is at least one bench. Okay. There is at least one bench which does not have the property. What is the property? Look at the set of students on that bench. Okay. At least one student must be from Telangana. That's false. That means what? Give me any student from that bench. Okay. And what do I know about yes? Is he from Telangana? No, he is not from Telangana. How many of you understand this? Negation, quick. Very good. Now, are you comfortable? Okay. Now you can see there are two things. A statement can involve more than one quantifier, but we have to write the quantifiers in proper order. And the first quantifier we have to negate. That we know because we are dealing with only one quantifier. Once I negate it, then the inside there will be a second quantifier possibly. That I have to negate. Okay. This is the way we have to negate. So that you see that it's much, much easier if you learn how to do that. Now, you see that such a simple statement already involved quite a bit of reasoned thinking, logical thinking. The next one I want to say is I want to write two statements. It's exactly similar to what I did earlier, but it has a universal message. So I would like to say that. Okay. Let R, okay, be the set of religions. You understand? Like Hinduism, okay, Christianity, Islam, Sikhism, Buddhism, Jainism, and including atheism. Okay, I will also think of it as a religion because you may say that I am an atheist. So I am just saying that. Okay. Now let P be set of people on earth. Okay. Now I am making two statements. What are those two statements? The first statement says the following. For every person X, P, okay, there exists an R which is a religion such that X follows the religion. Do you understand this? You take Alan Blackwell, okay, in all probability he is following Christianity. Okay, you take some Ismail Sahib, okay, he may be following Islam, right? If you take Sri Ram, he may be following Hinduism. Yeah, you take Sukhvinder Singh, he may be following Sikhism. So given any person, there is a religion so that X follows the religion. How many of you understand this? Yeah, right. Now notice that I am writing with the same quantifiers. I am writing this. There exists. I want a different color because this is what I would love to be true. Now, what does the second statement say? How many of you understand? Say yes. Those who understand second statement, say yes, quick. How many have said?
46.
Only here. Try to understand. As I said, visualize. Most of you are struggling because you don't do what I said. Visualize. What is meant by visualization? I will imagine. It says there exists R and R. Okay. Take some particular religion if you want. Then what does it say? Give me any person. It says something. Come on. It can't be difficult. After so much of common sense mathematics thing we have talked about. I'm not talking mathematics. How many?
56.
That's very bad. Come on. What does it say? There is an R and R. That is, you take a religion. Don't worry about its truth or falsity. Okay? Only the statement you have to understand. There is a religion. Take your favorite religion. Okay? Then what does it say? Give me any person on earth. Then that person belongs to the religion. He follows that religion. Now tell me which will be good for universal good. Which statement you want it to be true for human race? Yeah? How many of you know? Which should be true, but unfortunately it is not. Do you understand? How many of you understand? These two statements say something completely different. It says, give me a person, then there is some religion which he follows. I already gave example. Whereas the second one says, there exists one religion, so that everybody follows that religion. That is, all our people on earth follow only one religion, namely humanism. It will be nice if that's the case. How many of you understand? What I want to draw your attention to is, look at this. There exists an R in R. There is an R in R. For every X and P, for every X and P. They seem to be the same thing. Okay. And this statement is also same. X follows the religion R, etc. It's the same statement. So they look almost the same statement, but the order of the quantifiers are different. And hence the meaning is also completely different. I will give you 20 seconds. Please go through, understand, visualize, analyze, and appreciate. The quantifiers, the order in which you write is very, very important. 20 seconds. Once you have understood, please say yes.
It has touched the
60s. 60, yeah. Very good. Excellent. Now, do you see that? So, what are the things we have learned today? Let us summarize. Okay. First, we learn the use of quantifiers. Any statement, there may be quantifiers we have to figure out. Okay. For example, suppose I say this statement, given A in R, A positive, okay, there exists X in R, okay, then, okay, let me write it differently, sorry. Can you read it? I'll read it for you because my handwriting is not that good. If A is non-negative, then A equal to X squared for some X in R. Right? Now, do you see, assume if A is non-negative, that is given to you. Then I am making a statement. Do you see a quantifier involved in that? How many of you see the quantifier? I already said this earlier. If A is non-negative, if you want to start with quantifier, what quantifier you will start with? Ask somebody, please. As all groups have been asked?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay.
I'm second round away. Swati?
Given any A in R.
Okay, that is okay. But I said A is already given. There is nothing now. We have to do it. If you want, I can say that. I'm not making that statement now.
There exists A in R.
Very good. There exists? Read the second statement. A equal to x squared for some x in R. So what do you want to say? If A is non-negative, then?
Then there exists x in R such that A is equals to x squared.
Very good. Very good, Swati. Swati, right?
Yes, sir.
Very good. So this says, okay, this involves there exists x in R such that A equal to x squared. But if I want to make a universal statement, then I have to say for every A in R plus, where R plus is greater than or equal to 0 if you want. Okay. I am making a statement. Okay. So there will always be hidden in a statement. Most probably there will be the quantifiers hidden. Okay. Now we learned if the statement involves only one quantifier, how to negate. Second, we learned how to negate a statement which involves more than one quantifier. Third, we learn the order of quantifiers make difference. It's very, very crucial. If you change the order of quantifiers, the statement may be completely different. These are the three things we have learned today. How many of you appreciate this?
Stuck at 59, 60.
Good. Now, there is a final test for you. Okay. I say A is a non-unity subset. He is bounded above. If you want, I will be very precise in R. If, okay. Go through the definition. We already wrote the definition. Bounded above in R, if I can find alpha in R, so that alpha is an upper bound of A. Right? If I want to write this as a statement, a definition, there are quantifiers involved. How many quantifiers are involved? What is the order of quantifiers? Is the question clear? A subset A of R is bounded above if I can find an alpha in R, so that alpha is an upper bound of A. Okay? How many quantifiers are there? If you write carefully, otherwise there is only one. Okay. If you write carefully, how many quantifiers are there? And what is the order in which the quantifiers appear? Those of you who know the answer now, say yes. We will ask one of you. Quick. If the next group person is there, please ask.
Kannan? Kannan MR?
Next person, Suraj? Because he may have connectivity problem.
Suraj? Kodai?
For all and there exist.
What is the order? For all and there exists?
For all first and there exist follows.
Okay. What is your name? Kodai, yeah?
Yes, sir.
Sorry.
You know what I wanted to say here, right? Yeah. Can somebody else tell me? Next.
Sai Kumar.
Sir, only there exists.
What is it? Yeah.
Only there exists.
Only there exists. No. Yes. If you want to write it precisely, you need one more. Alpha is an upper bound. What is the definition of alpha is an upper bound? Okay. So let me write it. So many of you have a problem. I can see that. If there exists alpha in R, such that alpha is an upper bound. If you just leave it like that, that's fine. But alpha is an upper bound, we also have a definition. So if I try to expand that, for every alpha in R, alpha has some property. What is the property? For all x in A, x must be less than or equal to alpha. Therefore, the order in which the quantifiers appear is there exists followed by for all. How many of you understand this? Say yes, those who understand. Quick.
62.
Very good. Now, if I try to change like this, okay, I change this. This one I write it for all x in A, there exists alpha in R, so that x is less than or equal to alpha. That's what some students said. Okay. Right. Now, these two statements are the same or they are different. I say this is a correct definition and this is wrong. And try to understand what this really says. Okay, that will be for your discussion, but do this as a last. Do not work on this in the beginning. Try to go through systematically. Start with statements with one single quantifier. Try to learn to negate it. Then move on to two quantifiers. There exists followed by alpha. Sorry, there exists followed by for all, or for all followed by there exists. And try to learn to negate. And then try to understand this statement where the order in which the quantifiers appear is important. Okay. These are the things we should discuss in today's discussion hour. So we stop here.